The Lieutenant Governor joins us right now via Skype. And he, I have to say, remarkable setup, by the way. I love the John Wayne in Alamo. I love the cowboy hat. It's, you have one of the best setups that I have seen in all of the pandemic setting discussions. But it's good to have you. Thank you for joining me. I know it's been a little crazy. What made you offer to do that? Because I that is one of the things that struck me. I know that there's a GoFundMe out there, but yes. I think one of the things that also led to this is that, you know, being good stewards of our fellow man, you were really honestly like the only person that publicly said, you know what, I'm going to pay this fine. I'm going to do it. Why?
Well, first of all, Dana, we've done those things in the past. You know, sometimes they don't get publicity and we don't seek publicity on them. So if I see a need, I try to get there in some way and find the money to do that. And I was actually holding a press conference on a 150-page or so report that we released yesterday on how to reopen the economy. And as I was doing that press conference, someone asked me a question about her. And at the time, I didn't know she had a GoFundMe page. And I just said, you know, when they said it was a $7,000 fine, which I'd become aware of, I guess yesterday or the day before, I said, look, I'll just pay it or whatever the difference is. I had no idea what she had in the fund. And immediately after my press conference, I put the money in the fund. I put the $7,000 in. And I also said that I would be willing, if the judge would agree, that I would have in-house arrest so she could get out of jail. And I wasn't trying to grandstand, Dana. What I was actually hoping to do, and I didn't know much about the judge. I've never met Shelley. I don't know her. I've never met the judge. Don't know him. But I learned a lot after that. But when I said that, I was hoping maybe this would be a face-saving way that he could say, he's a far left-wing liberal judge, and I'm a right-wing Republican, that he might say, okay, I'll be happy to put Dan Patrick in his house for however many days and let her out. I just thought it might be a way to resolve it. And then I found out that this judge wasn't going to have any part of any compassion or mercy. My son, Dana, is a U.S. attorney and was a criminal court judge, and he was known as a tough judge, but he knew when mercy and compassion was needed. And yesterday or the day before, when we get lost track in days here, but when she was sentenced, I guess, on Tuesday, he showed no mercy or compassion. Dana, these people who, I'm a small business person, and when you have everything you own in your business and all of your dreams, when that's taken away, they're taking away everything you've ever had. And so people, she should not have violated the rules. And we said that last week. I made a statement that we don't want to send anyone to jail, but you need to follow the rules. And an appropriate small fine, $50 or $100, would have been fine. But to put her in jail, it's just unacceptable. And so the judge learned today you don't mess with Texas, because the governor changed his order. The attorney general came out strong. I came out strong. And she's out now, out of jail.
Yeah, that was quite speedy, the manner in which it happened, yeah. I have to say. And looking at how it all exploded on social media and also the people that have been out there protesting and standing in unity with her, you said something about the judge's compassion, and I wanted to come back to that, or the lack of, yeah, rather, because we hear so much about you need to have compassion. We're all sheltering, you know, in place and going by these phase one guidelines as it is to protect people, because no one was protesting ever stay at home orders. Everyone wanted to volunteer to be a good steward of their fellow man. Right. But it was that overreach that really got people. And when I was listening to the remarks this judge gave, and he said that her wanting to generate income was selfish. And, you know, I know you, Lieutenant Governor, you've seen how states, and not because no state can plan for this. No state can plan for that many people becoming unemployed because of a pandemic shutdown. And so websites everywhere were crashing. The workers were, everybody who was processing this are completely overwhelmed. And so it's very real that these people are getting in those situations where they have to generate that income. What guidance do you give for the enforcement of orders like this, but also that compassionate discretion to know when they're already suffering, they're already being punished?
Well, and that's the thing I try to take into account. And I don't think this judge, I don't know if he's ever owned a business. He's been a judge a long time, but I don't think people fully understand what small businesses, which employ about 50% of all the people working in America, I don't think they quite understand what small businesses go through. And so, for example, from early on, about the first week into this virus, and you may have seen my interview with Tucker, I was very clear that we have to protect life and take care of people first and foremost, but we can do two things at once. And we should never have shut down this economy like we have done. And that was based on bad models and bad science. I mean, remember, Dr. Fauci said in January this wouldn't impact us, and 6 weeks later we're going to have 2 million dead. And so the president was given limited information from those doctors, and it was very scary information, as were governors, myself, everyone. And so we acted those first couple of weeks based on what they told us. But the truth was, we can do two things at once. And so I've always been wanting to reopen this economy. We're kind of leading the way, I think, now in the United States, each week opening more. But what I understand about the small business is there's still a lot of people, particularly Democrats, said, well, we need to wait. We can hold another 30 days. And you see some of these states that are holding another 30 or 45 days. Small business, Dana, can't wait. I mean, you when you have no money coming in, because you have no customers, you still have rent to pay, you still have utilities to pay, and you can't just not pay all of them, or suddenly the dominoes start to fall. So we have to get America back to work in a safe way, and that's what we're doing in Texas, and we should do all across America. I know New York and New Jersey has a little different of an issue, but even there, much of what they've done, they've now found out that most of that virus was caused at home, as the governor said yesterday in New York, not by people being out. We have to go back to get this country up and running step by step so that we can get this economy rolling, and people like Shelley never have to protest again or ever go to jail because she's protecting her employees, which she really talked about, the 18 women that worked for her.
Yeah, exactly. Shelley Luther. And then, of course, there was the story of the bar that was in Ector County, Texas, West Odessa, where that, what do you make of the response on that? Because, you know, I have to tell you, I was a little, it was a little disconcerting to see that amount of response to five people who were out there at a, didn't look like a big old fancy bar, but it was a bar nonetheless. It was supplying someone's income. Right. That seemed to be a little heavy-handed. And I say that I'm being very generous there. It seemed a little heavy-handed, that kind of response. And then you have the Laredo story where the two women who were cosmetologists that were doing manicures and lashes in their own homes, they weren't hurting anyone. They were also jailed. And I know that the modified executive order affects that as well. What are your responses to some of that enforcement of that? What is your take on it?
Well, once again, you have to use discretion in life, just in life. You know, when are you going to tangle with someone or not? And I think, and I surely am not faulting law enforcement, because let me tell you something else, Dana. They're under tremendous stress. They're working long hours. You have a lot of cases. I mean, we have one whole small city's department that tested positive. We've had to send in the state troopers just to man that city. So everyone's working long hours. They're under stress. We don't need to put them in any way that they feel in danger. So I respect that. But what happened yesterday in Odessa, and I haven't been involved in that case as much as this one, but to the best of my knowledge, what happened was she violated the orders again. Again, I don't think she should have been arrested, but there were some people there with their long guns, which is perfectly legal, except you can't, as you know, carry a gun, at least in Texas law, in a bar that where 51% of the revenues are alcohol. Sales, yeah. So that's why you can't carry a gun into a bar in Texas. And so apparently, we'll see what the facts are at the end of the day. So it was kind of two separate issues. And so for the police that came there, when they saw a number of people, you know, you can carry long guns legally in public, but you can't do it where they're selling alcohol, 51% or more. So they judged that, and they did come in with a heavy response because, again, a lot of people are very tense today. You know, who knows what's going on in the mind of anyone? And so the police acted to protect themselves. And I think to, as opposed to just pulling up with two people, a show of force to make sure there was no violence. But the woman who owned the bar, she was not part of that. She didn't invite those people just happened to come to her bar. But she was arrested on the same basis that Shelley was arrested in Dallas, and that was she was violating, because we haven't opened the bars yet in Texas.
Right.
But again, you know, if she needs help, we'll reach out and help her. And now the governor changed the order today. He's rescinded the order. And there were standards. You know, when the governor issued the executive order on April 2nd, it did say if you violate these orders, and we do want people to follow the orders if they're given, but they're recommendations, they are orders, and most people follow them. But the governor had no intention of putting anyone in jail. Again, neither did the attorney general or myself. We never, you know, none of these things are state actions. These are local elected officials making these decisions.
Right.
And that's the same case happened in Laredo. So Hopefully this is passed now, and we've opened up barbershops and or salons, or will tomorrow, thank goodness, because I need a haircut. I haven't had one for 8 weeks. My wife will be happy as well. So that'll put all that to rest on top of it.
Well, one last quick question for you, and we're talking with the Lieutenant Governor of Texas, Dan Patrick. You brought up a point that I'd actually written about on my website. Because I went and I was looking through the state guidelines on, you know, when you're reopening, these are the practices, et cetera, et cetera. And you mentioned that that's not the state guideline for enforcement. And that's kind of the thing. It's different county by county, department by department. So there's a lot of room for discretion there. Do you think that there should be going forward to either to minimize abuse, or to minimize even creating unnecessarily any sort of bad relationship between law enforcement and the community, and just also clarifying it for everyone across the state, just like some statewide guidelines as to how to deal with these situations?
Absolutely. And look, this is, I think Governor Abbott's done a terrific job, and I think Texas is leading the way. We've been very fortunate that our death rate, every life is valuable, but is lower per capita than I think any place in the country, just about, or in the world. We've had less than 1,000 people out of 29 million people pass, and most of those, 75% over the age of 65, and had health issues. But every one of those lives is valuable. But my point is that we are all citizens, all of us. We're all walking through this together. So I think one thing as we go forward, if this happens again, or we have a second wave, and hopefully this never happens again, but we do have to have uniformity. We have a lot of patchwork, and obviously state to state can make those decisions, but even within a state. For example, here in Dana, and I'll be real quick, we didn't lock down the state. We didn't close churches. We didn't, you know, say you can't do this or that. It was really local decisions, and we as conservative Republicans who lead the state tried to have a moderate hand in that. And some of the cities made their own decisions. And I think it's confusing to the citizens going county to county, city to city. They can change. And so I think we'll look at that more in the future. And I think what the governor did today by revising his order said no one can be confined, which means they can't be sent to jail if they violate an order that he issues. And again, we want people to follow law and order. Again, when I look at the lady with the bar in West Texas, you know, when they had her in handcuffs yesterday, she said, "What more can they do to me? I've lost everything I have." When you take away everything someone has, they have no hope. They'll do things that they would not normally do. Right. I don't think Shelley's a lawbreaker. She violated an order. She did it for her business and her employees, and under a lot of stress. So that's where mercy and compassion and understanding comes in. And not in all cases, but mostly what you see, Dana, around the country is where you really have these draconian measures and people quick to throw people in jail. Yes. Not every case, but almost all. It's a Democrat governor, Democrat county judge, Democrat mayor.
Yes.
And they seem to, I heard that line before that her lawyer mentioned, tiny tyrants. Some of these people are consumed with power, and that's why it would be very dangerous for this country to ever fall in the hands from top to bottom in this country, more governors or in the White House and Congress. If the liberals and the left that think like this took over our country, we wouldn't have an America that you and I grew up in. Thank you for all your work on the Second Amendment. You're a leader in that and all you do, and I'm a big fan, and thank you for everything you do every day.
Well, I appreciate that. And I have to, while I have you, Lieutenant Governor, I have to tell people, because everyone knows you and I have disagreed on certain issues before, but I love to highlight to people, look, You can disagree with people on certain issues, and on other issues work together. You don't have to, you know, I disagree with my husband on certain things, but it doesn't mean that we have divorced. I mean, that's kind of
I think maybe we've only disagreed. Maybe 1%. I can't think. I'd have to go through a litany test. Someone said one time that you had said that I was a supporter of red flag laws. And just for the record on your show, I'm actually the person in the Texas Senate in 2017 that killed the red flag law on the first day. I said, we're not passing any red flag laws in Texas. And that's, I'm the guy that killed it, didn't support it. So I just want to set the record straight.
I think it was the private transfers that you and I disagree on.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was.
Well, we'll talk about that.
Yeah, we've talked about that on the show, but I love hearing that about the red flag, because you appreciate due process. And I love that. That is a bright spot in my day. So I love hearing that.
No, we killed it. It's on the record. First day of session. We're not going to take out any bills. As the Lieutenant Governor, I'm President of the Senate. So we get a chance to, as Lieutenant Governor, decide what bills come to the floor or not. And I said, this bill's not even getting to committee.
Excellent. That is good to hear. Lieutenant Governor, I appreciate you being on with us, and I appreciate also the speed with which that you and the AG and the governor have listened to Texans crying out about this and saying we're hurting, and just having a little bit more grace and compassion and not assigning the worst misinterpretations of something to people like Shelley Luther than, you know, the judge that was in her case. Thank you for that, Lieutenant Governor Dan
Patrick.
Appreciate
you
being on.
Thank you, Dana.
Thank you. Take care.